Hello, and welcome to, episode 9 of season 6. Well, 2 weeks ago, the breaking news was the Boston bombings, Boston Marathon bombing. Well, I, amongst others, labeled it as a false flag event. Just from our past experience, we know what they do over and over and over and over again. The FBI instigates most of the terrorist threats that we have. I have lots of sources. I've played other documentaries on that very subject here before. It turns out that we were absolutely right. Those Chechen bombers, first of all, it was originally supposed to be Timothy McVeigh types. All of the news people came out early and they were vying with each other to be the first one to announce that it was a lone wolf American domestic terrorist. But info warriors, in other words, activists who had questions and wanted them answered, forced people to look at the evidence that was abounding everywhere. And the evidence showed that it wasn't the person that they thought. I mean, it wasn't any redneck domestic terrorist. So they had to switch, fall back to plan B. They probably had plan C, D, E, F, and G there waiting in case they needed it. But plan B was to fall back on the old, you know, Islamophobia. That's a real useful tool. You can turn the American sheeple into vicious warmongers that way. Well, the problem is that this is probably the best example of a false flag that fell apart almost as fast as it was created. I mean, it was exposed from day one. It turns out that the Russians, well, let's fall back. These guys were both CIA operatives. They had been active in the terrorist attacks on Russia from Chechnya. Now, Chechnya was, I mean, all the terrorism in Chechnya is sponsored by the CIA. These two guys were CIA lackeys that had gone over there to create trouble, and the Russians exposed them. They said, why are you talking to the CIA? Hey, turn off my mic in here. Anyway, why is the CIA sending these, you know, provocateurs over to Russia to cause trouble? And they sent them back, and like the evidence has shown, these guys have been on the terrorist watch list for 3 years or something like that, and been associated with the FBI and the CIA both for 5 years. And yet they want us to believe that these are just lone wolf, you know, Muslims, though. They're Muslims. Don't forget they're Muslims. That'll turn off your brain. You won't think about anything else except that they're Muslims. That's how insidious this is. Well, I'm going to go ahead and play this first clip here. It's 3 minutes long, and it'll kind of sum up what I've been talking about. And, well, then we'll just take it from there. But this is really something that, right in front of your eyes, it's falling apart. The police state is being implemented, and so many people don't even realize it yet. We're way past the point where we criticize the Nazis, you know, for why did you sit there and let them do all that? Why did you sit there and let them implement the police state in Nazi Germany? Well, now we can answer that question, or we should. Why did we sit here and let us institute the police state? Well, anyway, I'm going to go ahead and start the video.
Hi, I'm Leanne McAdoo here with an InfoWars news bulletin. Now, we've been working really hard to try and keep track of all of the inconsistencies with the official story behind the Boston Marathon bombing, and there are so many of them that I'm going to just try to focus on five here today, and then you can go to InfoWars.com and check out some additional articles that will detail all of the inconsistencies even further. The media announced that the suspects were in custody at the Boston courthouse. The courthouse is suddenly evacuated due to a bomb threat, and the new official word is there are no suspects in custody. FBI releases footage of the suspects without ever showing them actually setting down the backpack. In fact, even Governor Deval Patrick had not seen the video, although he described the footage showing the suspect placing the bomb near the second blast site as chilling. He then mentioned that he hadn't actually seen the footage himself, but was relayed the info by the FBI. So you're the governor of Massachusetts overseeing this manhunt, and you yourself haven't even seen the footage? The boy's father says that if the FBI kills his second son, then he will know it was a setup. Hours later, the boy is captured alive, but is conveniently unable to speak. The reports say that he suffered from a self-inflicted gunshot wound through the mouth that exited his neck. How does a person who's just shot himself in the mouth climb out and over a boat, surrendering himself to authorities? As Alex Jones reported, the Saudi national suspect, named first as a person of interest, was almost immediately cleared of suspicion after both John Kerry and Obama met with Saudi Foreign Minister Saad just after the Boston Marathon bombing. We were then told Abdul Rahman Ali Al-Arbi is being deported for reasons of national security. The Blaze released more information showing that the FBI was deporting him under Section 212(3B) and that he was linked somehow to the Boston bombings. But after the president's meeting with the foreign minister, the file was changed. We now know the Al-Arbi clan has major ties to Al-Qaeda, and although the 20-year-old was already on a terrorist watch list, he was still given a student visa. This is all strangely similar to the flights by the bin Laden family, who are also Saudi nationals, right after 9/11. Why did the FBI ask for the public's help in finding these guys? It's already widely reported that the FBI had been alerted to Tamerlan Tsarnaev at least as early as 2011. Homeland Security said they reviewed the man's associations with suspected extremists, his travel and education history, and concluded that there wasn't incriminating information to prove he had extremist leanings. Is this just another case of the FBI allowing a terror attack to take place in order to take advantage of a crisis? Now, we would just like to say thank you to everyone who's been sharing your information, sending it to tips@infowars.com. All of your information has actually helped to keep us on top of all of the breaking news. So thank you, and keep sending the information. I'm Leanne McAdoo, and this has been an InfoWars News Bulletin.
Okay, isn't that great how you can sum up everything in just a three-minute video? Well, I'm not sure how she pronounces her name. Alex Jones calls her Sybelle Edmonds. I always call her Sybelle. I've never heard her say it. But anyway, Ms. Edmonds is one of the most knowledgeable people ever. She was the one who she blew the whistle on the FBI when she found out that bin Laden, for instance, was on the CIA payroll all the way through and after 9/11. That's just one of the things. But she is an expert in that area, you know, including Russia, Chechnya, and all that. So I'm going to play the first 15 minutes of a 45-minute interview with her on the Alex Jones Show again. And judge for yourself. I think you'll really enjoy. I mean, she packs in the information, and there's much more of it to be had. But this is worth it. 15 minutes, and I'll be back. And then we'll open up the phone lines and see what happens.
Them is courage. And Sybelle Edmonds was an FBI high security clearance translator. And because she can speak Arabic and several other languages, and she was listening before, during, and after 9/11, and she went to Congress, told them what she knew, and they gagged her. She pretty much broke the gag order. Incredible courage. You've seen the persecution of whistleblowers the last few years, who even exposed crime. And they, basically threatened her and things, but she hasn't been thrown in jail. Ladies and gentlemen, it takes a lot of courage to go up against these people. Most men I know will not do it. They won't even admit this is going on, but Sybelle Edmonds did that. We'll give you her website. I'm on the road. I'm pulling up a story she really wants us to look at, so we'll let her break that here. We've got Riding Shotgun, Jakari Jackson, and David Knight. They'll be hosting the whole next hour, and they're going to have Syrian Girl on, breaking down the fact they're trying to frame them for chemical weapons. But I have to say to Sybelle, because I heard her on TV a few days ago, or saw her on TV, we linked to it from RT, with Abby Martin, excellent piece, going over the fact that this could be a false flag. Could be. I mean, knowing what she knows, I'm not going to recap it all, but we know this. The FBI, CIA was on these guys for 5 years. It's now confirmed, mainstream news in Europe, in Russia, that he was in a CIA-sponsored Zbigniew Brzezinski program to undermine the Caucasus where they're putting al-Qaeda in. This is a total setup. And this is a message to all the patsies out there. People that think you're part of national security stuff, you're playing the part of a terrorist to infiltrate groups, you're going to be set up a lot of times. And the little brother was just tagging along. He was partying the night before. He had no idea. They've cut his throat out. He climbed out of the boat, and they tried to kill him. He's been told, you're dead if you don't play ball. Same thing happened with McVeigh. They do the same thing over and over again. That's how I'm able to tell you what's going to happen. I had Richard Belzer on when it was announced, and I said, there'll be a drill. The people will be handled. They'll set up patsies that openly work for intelligence groups. People are like, how did you know this, Jones? People are so freaked out right now. They're saying, you know, that Jones must be a government agent or something. Well, if I am a government agent, we need more like me. No, I'm not. I'm a liberty lover who studied what they do. It's so pathological. Now, Sybil Edmonds has been a total insider and a real government agent that went public, and she has a news website that we're going to put on screen for TV viewers and let her plug here on air. But, Sybil, I want you to take the floor here. Then my reporters have a few questions for you at the next segment, and talk about your case briefly to recap it, and then what did you think the minute you saw the Boston bombing? Because I know, being a false flag expert, someone who's covered it for 15, 16 years, actually longer than that, but I've really been on it since Oklahoma City, so I guess 18 years. This is like flashbacks for me. It's very painful. I wish this wasn't an inside job, because that's a lot less scary than, you know, to have a few lone nuts out there than to know that the system is this corrupt. And then why would they do it? Sybil, thank you so much for joining us.
Hi, Alex. Good to be with you again. And as far as my case is concerned, I'm not going to get into the civil liberties and the details of my case, but I want to emphasize the fact that since my case broke in 2002 with all the state secrets privilege and gag orders, I have been emphasizing the reason for the state secrets privilege and also the gag orders being our operation, and this is us, the United States government's operations in Central Asia and Caucasus. Some direct operations, also through proxy nations such as NATO member Turkey in this region. And that includes all the stands, you know, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Kazakhstan, but also in the Caucasus, Chechnya, Dagestan. And so this has been pretty much a consistent theme for the past 10 years with my case. And every time I have given an interview or talk about it, people go like, oh, stand Central Asia, Caucasus. Even people,
no, you always bring that up because that's what you were listening to. And this is part of the public program in that Red Crescent to destabilize that. This is a public program. What is incredible is that it's all public, but the public's so ignorant, it's like we're speaking Martian.
Oh, well, a lot of it, Alex, you say, is public info, but the mainstream media has really never, ever, ever covered this. And a lot of the pseudo alternatives that you know about, I know about, our listeners know about, they never touch these regions. But now, lo and behold, with this incident in Boston, suddenly it put this region, the Caucasus, Chechnya, and Dagestan on the map. You know, these people went from freedom fighter rebels overnight with Boston incidents into the hottest terrorist cell, hottest al-Qaeda terror cell, hottest Islamic radical cell, parroting each other, getting their script from the State Department, from the CIA, especially the New York Times and LA Times, Washington Post, but also to a certain degree, a lot of these quasi-alternative media. And I know a lot of people, they got bogged down with all these ever-changing, ever-conflicted, contradictory semantics and details.
But the bottom line is these guys were working for Western intelligence. The Russians blew their cover. For people that don't know, you've been saying publicly for 10 years since you broke the gag order, with a lot of courage, as I said earlier, that it was a crime network from Central Asia right through the stands, right into the Caucasus, right into Albania, right into Southern Europe, Eastern Europe, right into... So explain the big picture, because you were on the inside listening to all this. Explain to people what's happening here on the Brzezinski grand chessboard, and then how that fits into these brothers.
Sure. So as I was saying, while people were bogged down with all these ever-changing information, which is in a way is a matter of distraction, people, you know, making a lot of, putting out a lot of hypotheses and talking about some details on the ground, we came out as Boiling Frogs Post and we talked about the bigger picture. And that's exactly what the U.S. government, that's what exactly the mainstream media don't want people to look at, to step back and look at the big picture. Number one, the fact that they were from this region, you know, with connections to Chechnya, Dagestan. These are not even nations. These are regions within Russian territory and Russia. And the other thing I talked about, of course, the interview you referred to was a good interview with Abby Martin, but was very short, so I really couldn't get into it. And that's why we have a much longer interview from 5 days before that on our website when I get to explain. For example, one of the things that keep coming out of the parents for the suspects were that, you know, this thing dated back to 3 to 5 years ago. And while FBI was talking about 2 years, you know, Russians notifying the FBI at the end of 2011. The other inconsistency that is very important, and I'm going to link it to this great game in a second, had to do with the style that the parents were talking about, the style of the communication relationship of these government officials with the suspects. Right away, I said, first of all, that seems to be the recruitment style, you know, especially if it dated 3 to 5 years ago. And considering these guys, especially the older brothers, language, linguistic skills, you know, he speaks Russian, Chechen, the Turkic language, and English. He still
for people that don't know, they come to like, you know, they come to people when they're like 16, 17, 18, this is 5 years ago, and say, you are powerful. You're a leader. The CIA needs you to infiltrate these groups. So you get these party animals, suddenly you're going to mosques saying, I want to blow everyone up. They think they're finding radical Muslims, but really they're creating the ledger in the history to be set up.
Well, I would be careful to characterize it as infiltrating, because when you're talking about these groups, Alex, and this goes to my case, and this goes to what I've been referring to for the past 11 years, well, these groups are our groups. We, the United States, created these groups, okay?
Oh, no. I totally agree with you. It's on record the State Department runs the Islamic terror groups, all of them in the stands. You're the expert, but I mean, that's all admitted. You're misunderstanding. I'm saying when they sent the brothers around to shoot their mouths off at mosque about how they, you know, how they hate America and stuff, and then they go party at the dorm at night, that is clearly them thinking they're agents infiltrating radical groups, is what I'm saying, when in truth they're creating their history, their ledger to be set up later.
No, I understand. And one of the other things I need to emphasize right here at this point is, initially when the report came out, there were a lot of people who said, well, these guys only associated with modern, you know, wealthy Turkish students and businessmen there. And we didn't see any signs of radicalization. They were hanging out in BMWs, going to nightclubs. And now you're referring to this thing of some of these people coming and saying, this is what they said in the mosque. That's why I haven't been really covering all these changing contradictory details, because after
it's
8, 9 days, we can get a lot of people, exactly, you're right, to come and say. And
okay, then I'm going to shut up. Listen, here's what I'm going to do. Then you've got the floor. What is the core of this and what people need to know? Go ahead.
Well, Alex, this really makes me feel special. You're giving me the floor. I'm really honored. Thank you. So what I pointed out, the fact that, okay, these people are exact profile that CIA seeks, especially in the United States, we don't have many people from Caucasus. So the older brother is a perfect operative for the CIA to recruit. That was the number one thing we put out through our website and said, nobody's talking about the CIA connection. Everybody's putting the focus on FBI. And I believe that the Russians did, in fact, contact the FBI at the end of 2011. FBI went there. They came back, and they were told by the CIA to butt out, to zip, and not to close the case. Because while I was working at the FBI with the agents on these operations, this was a recurring theme, Alex. We would have a lot of investigations. We would open up. We would, pursue suspects. And lo and behold, either the State Department, and again, I have been saying this for 11 years, or CIA would step in and would pressure the SES level people, the top tier level people in the FBI, to shut down the investigations, to close the investigations, because whatever we were looking at or whoever we were looking at happened to be our guys from the CIA and State Department side. So, and this went to a lot of 9/11 related cases where we had actively just in my own department alone, several cases where the CIA came and said, you're going to shut this investigations and you're not going to pursue this person. Or actually, CIA facilitated the suspect's exit from the country, from the United States, immediately, weeks after 9/11. So that was very similar. The other thing that I kept telling people to look at is what is going to happen immediately after this terror incident, the so-called scripted terror incident. I said, watch three areas very carefully, and this is what you're going to be seeing. And guess what? In the past 2 days, what we put out a week ago saying this is what's going to take place is already in effect. It's already taking place. Number one, I said, well, the biggest obstacle for us to go and actually directly invade Syria, because we have the military power, we can take it, we can take them out in 2 days, okay? Go to Syria and get rid of Assad and do this and finish it, invade a la Libya, you know, a la Egypt. But I said the only obstacle has been Russia. Now, with this connection, suddenly we changing hats saying, well, these guys that we created for a while, we are going to declare them the terrorists, the hot Al-Qaeda cell. Look, again, we have done this throughout the history with Mujahideens that we created, Al-Qaeda, Bin Laden in Afghanistan. At some points, they were our freedom fighters. They were our guys. At some point, they were terrorists. And sometimes we do it several times. KLA, okay, in the Balkans with Albanians. We had KLAs under terrorist category with the State Department. Then during the Balkan War, we made them the freedom fighters, our allies. We lift that terrorist title. And then after we were finished, we were done, we put that title back again. We do this a lot with, and same thing with MEK, the Mujahideen Khalq. Some people refer to them as MKO. Now look at Chechens, right? Suddenly Chechens are the terrorists and all these bad guys. Do you know who's the biggest lobby for the Chechens? In several years ago, they established a Chechen lobby. Guess who established it? James Woolsey, ex-CIA director, Michael Ladin, Frank Gaffney, Richard Pearl. When you look at the names of these lobbyists that set up this the Committee for Peace in Chechnya, okay, the American Committee for Peace in Chechnya, a lobby group for Chechens, you're looking at all the infamous CIA, DIA, Pentagon, and the neocons, okay? Later, after it got a little bit scandalous, they changed the Chechnya in the title into Caucasus, the American Committee for Peace in Caucasus, right? This is not even a nation we are talking about, Chechnya. And now we have this big group, lobby group, with all the CIA and neocon guys for Chechnya, sure, and Chechens. People have to ask this. So this is what, you know, what happens. Now, I pointed out that there is a possibility that we made a backdoor deal with the Russians, okay? Look, step aside and let us go and invade Syria directly, okay? For a while, we'll declare the Chechen and these guys in Dagestan as the most radical Al-Qaeda terrorists overnight, okay? We'll set it up, we'll script it for you. And we'll give you the free hand because Russia has been pretty much wary of really tackling some of these cells within its own regions. Because if you look at the map, you see that the region is very close, right on the border of Georgia. Now, recall that conflict in 2008, the five-day war between Georgia and Russia. So it's a very volatile region. Plus, Russia, people are like, well, Russia doesn't need permission from the United States, but you have to look at the geopolitics and you
it
also
needs
have
the political cover. They need the
exactly.
political cover.
Look, Russia doesn't want that kind of a bad rep when the EU, the United States says, look, Russia is repressing these minorities, they are committing genocide. So they have been kind of wary, even though their intelligence have all the stuff, information on these cells.
Sure, we're about to go to break. Really. Let me just throw this question at you, and then we can come back and you can have the floor continually, sure, and finish up, sure, these important points you're making. Why would then the Georgian government, along with the Russians, release their military the documents that he's at the CIA Jamestown-funded, Woolsey-controlled, Zbigniew Brzezinski-controlled meetings? Why would Georgia, I know it's moving a little bit away from the West now, but why would Georgia do that? I mean, they're obviously upset about this. So what does it signify?
Because we produced this video report and an hour in-depth interview on this. And during this interview, I pounded the issue and I said, I'm really asking for some factions within the Russian government, intelligence, and Georgia to put out information because their intelligence for years, for more than two decades, have been collecting all our operations.
Well, you did do that, absolutely. So stay there.
Okay, you know, we go into an Alex Jones commercial there, and then Sybil comes back. I recommend that you go to YouTube or go to Boiling Frogs. postspot.com, whatever it is, Boiling Frogs, you'll find it, Sybil Edmonds, Boiling Frogs post, or Boiling Frogs blog. Go join up with her site. It's worth it. But now you see, there's nothing off the table. Any skullduggery, any emotional blackmail, anything that they can use to further their goal, they'll use. And Islamophobia, the one thing we claim, we aren't targeting Muslims. No, it just so happens that everybody that ever blows up something is a Muslim. Everybody that hates America is a Muslim. Everybody that does something terrible is a Muslim. Everybody that's evil and terrible is Muslim. But we are not Islamophobic. Sorry. No, it's just the facts. It's just that we know it's an evil religion. We know that Christianity is the best religion. And we know that Islam is a really bad religion. And that's all we need. We don't need facts. We don't need evidence. We don't need truth. Well, we're going to go to Russia Today, Breaking the Set with Amy Martin for a little bit of that Islamophobia background. And then we'll come back with Marcella, and we'll talk about the latest in AE 9/11 Truth Movement. Open up the phones for about 15 minutes. So here we go.
And bombings, there's one aspect of the media's coverage that I haven't talked about, the sensationalistic machine that's pumping out fear, racism, and discrimination against one group, Muslims. Take a look.
I don't care if she knew about this. She ought to be in prison for wearing a hijab. This immigration policy of you know, us assimilating immigrants into our culture isn't really working. No, they're assimilating us into their culture. Did she get a clitorectomy too?
Who else does that? What other theology in this world justifies murdering innocent people? The answer is only radical Islam allows terror murder.
There are some who are getting very leery of all the Muslim students in America. Our own Bob Beckel among those saying, maybe stop granting them visas. Others have spoken of slowing down the number of get into this country, checking them out more closely.
Let me just say this about the access that Muslims have in this country, whether they're American Muslims or whether they're here on a student visa, it is enormous, the access that they have, and it is virtually all radical.
Yes, I know that was all mostly Fox News, but the sentiment of Islamophobia is being echoed across the political and media establishment alike, and has been since 9/11. This kind of rhetoric toxifies the public's perception of the fastest growing religion in the world, one that's inherently peaceful. And unfortunately, this mindset does nothing more than incite hatred and violence against a growing population. So here to talk about the culture of Islamophobia and what we can do to combat this mindset going forward, I'm joined now by Arslan Iftikha, senior editor for the Islamic Monthly and founder of themuslimguy.com. Thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you, Abby.
So why is it that when white people go on a shooting spree, it's an aberration? It's considered that they're mentally ill. Yet when there's a Muslim with a bomb, that is just exclusively terrorism.
It's because, Abby, the term terrorism has been co-opted after September 11th to really only apply when brown Muslim dudes commit an act of terror. You know, in the last year, we've seen the Newtown, Connecticut school shooting. We saw the Aurora, Colorado Dark Knight movie massacre. In all of those cases, it was just a white kooky loner that was doing it. Less than a year ago also, we had a white supremacist named Wade Michael Page who walked into a Sikh Gurdwara temple in Oak Creek, Wisconsin, and slaughtered six people in cold blood. And he had a race war ideology. But the term domestic terrorism was rarely used. I assure you, if it was a brown dude who walked into a white church in Wisconsin and killed six innocent people, regardless of his political ideology, he would have been referred to as a terrorist.
And also, just there's been multiple bombings of abortion clinics by right-wing Christians. We don't hear them. We don't hear people really talking about that as terrorism either. It's really fascinating. You know, I consider anyone who wants to kill innocent people mentally unstable. Why is there no discussion about their mental stability, and instead the conversation is only about radical Islam and international terrorism, trying to link these kids automatically to some international terror plot?
Well, as you know, in America, we've always needed to have a proverbial boogeyman. We've always needed an enemy. During the 70s and 80s in the Cold War, it was the Russian Red Scare. And now in the millennial age, it's become the Green Muslim Scare. And so, you know, a lot of it is based on Americans' perceptions of what's going on. If they don't know about, you know, a Sikh temple shooting being referred to as an act of domestic terrorism, or if the Newtown, Connecticut school shooting or the Dark Knight movie massacre in Colorado are now referred to as domestic terrorism, it shows that there is a disconnect there. You know, a few days before the Tsarnaev brothers were listed as suspects, you know, CNN and other networks erroneously reported that a, quote, dark-skinned male was arrested. Even though this turned out to be false, it shaped the narrative that it was those other guys doing it, and it's not a problem that, you know, white America has as well.
Yes, absolutely. And putting that kind of the preconceived notion out there, kind of the preconditioning almost kind of aids that perception. And a lot of people don't follow up and see if that was later retracted or they don't know who these people were. And the media, of course, is so quick to criticize Obama. And this is really strange to me, for not hastily declaring it to be an act of terrorism. I mean, as if that really means anything, considering how meaningless the word has become in a post 9/11 world, which according to them, him not jumping on within minutes of the Boston bombings either makes him a Muslim apologist or a Muslim himself. I mean, what kind of damage does this extreme rhetoric from many talking heads in the media do to just the conversation that we need to be having in this country right now?
Well, you know, Abby, most people are aware that we are currently or have fought two wars in predominantly Muslim nations, that most of our foreign policy today dealing with much of the rest of the world revolves around dealing with Muslim nations. And you saw the crypto, you know, the whisper campaigns of Barack being some sort of crypto Muslim Manchurian candidate. You know, whenever somebody says that Barack Obama is a Muslim, I feel like Jerry Seinfeld should pop out and say, not that there's anything wrong with that. It's a slur today. It's an accepted form of otherization. And, you know, that's part of the reason that President Obama has never set foot inside an American mosque, because the minute that he would do so during a political campaign, the right-wingers would point at it and say, look, see, we told you so.
It's unbelievable. But if you take these attacks into account, along with 9/11, you're still more likely to slip and die in the shower than you are to die of a terrorist attack in this country. Of course, that doesn't accompany the narrative of fear driving all of this stuff going on. In fact, the large majority of FBI, of terrorist plots in the last decade foiled have been concocted by the FBI. The large majority. I mean, what is this manufacturing of terror doing to really aid and kind of breed this undercurrent of Islamophobia?
Well, it's important to keep in mind that a lot of studies have been done that have shown that in the last decade or two decades, the vast majority, over 90% of domestic terrorism plots that have been foiled here in the United States were committed by white domestic terrorists. And so, you know, when we hear narratives about, you know, Islamic terrorism being, you know, the sort of existential threat of our time, you know, it's one of the threats. There are a lot of threats out there. You know, a few years ago, there was a 48-year-old white American Tea Party member named Joe Stack who flew his single-engine plane into an IRS building in Austin, Texas. Now, if it was a brown dude who had flown his plane into an IRS building in Austin, Texas, we would have shut down every IRS building in the country. We would have shut down every federal building in the country, and we would have called it what it is, an act of terrorism. But because a right-wing nut named Joe Stack and not Ali Muhammad did something, it's not an act of terrorism. And so this double standard in terms of the term terrorism needs to be called out.
Right, and of course they just said, oh, he's mentally ill, he's mentally unstable, he's not a terrorist. We didn't see the right, police, militarized, paramilitary troops in the streets.
Only white people can have mental illnesses.
Right, of course, of course. And also, just omitting the fact that these kids have cited the wars abroad as a motivating factor, of course, they're zeroing in on being radicalized abroad, coming home with this radical ideology from Russia and all this stuff, really omitting kind of that glaring aspect, hey, blowback. Hello. I mean, is this a real concept?
And at the end of the day, you know, at the end of the day, these guys were just criminal losers.
They're criminal psychos.
And
yeah.
it's something that obviously is, you know, antithetical to any major religious teaching. And, you know, even the mosque in Boston that the elder one went to kicked him out because he started yelling at them during a Friday sermon that was praising Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So even the Muslim community in Boston had shunned this guy, and therefore he went and he radicalized by himself.
But of course you still hear people like Bill O'Reilly, and I'm just going to paraphrase this because we don't have time to play it, but he basically said that Muslim Americans should apologize on behalf of whenever these things happen. How do you respond to something like that?
Well, I respond by saying, you know, did white Americans apologize after Timothy McVeigh bombed the Alfred P. Murrow Federal Building in Oklahoma City? And then people say, well, you know, religion was an ideology there. Actually, it was. His co-conspirator, Terry Nichols, was a self-professed member of the Christian Identity Movement. And so why is it that one minority group in America is placed with collective guilt more than any other demographic group in America? If we're going to ask people to apologize for the acts of a few, then we should ask everyone to apologize for the acts of a few. But that's ridiculous because that's a completely un-American principle.
It is. And like you said before, I keep going back to this proverbial boogeyman. I mean, every generation has their own, and really it necessitates these perpetual wars. I mean, you need this proverbial boogeyman for people to be scared of, to dehumanize the enemy, to allow these wars to continue. It really is just a vicious cycle. And unfortunately, what accompanies all of this is this extreme discrimination, the incitement of violence, racial profiling, as you said, a Saudi national, which is odd that they call them that anyway, apprehended, interrogated, and then all these calls now from politicians and pundits like to block Muslim student visas from coming into the country. Is this the worst of it, or do you expect more backlash to come?
I expect more backlash to come. I mean, even in the days following the Boston Marathon bombings, you know, there was a report of a Palestinian Muslim woman who wears the hijab, the headscarf, who was accosted by a white male who started yelling profanities at her, saying, F you Muslims, you did the Boston Marathon bombing. A day after the Boston bombings, there was a man in a New York City mosque who was actually followed by an armed individual who was also yelling out anti-Muslim slurs. And so sadly, this has become part and parcel of what many in the American Muslim community have faced since 9/11. And you know, we're going to probably continue to face it for the foreseeable future.
Well, what can we do? I mean, we're becoming more of a melting pot. Islam's one of the largest growing religions. I mean, what can we do to end this guilt by association? And really, how damaging is this to the cultural fabric of our nation? We have about 30 seconds left.
It's very important, and we need politicians. We need members of the administration. We need brave members of Congress and the Senate to come out and challenge, you know, all these right-wing talking points that are coming out. And until we do so, you know, people like myself are going to have to come out into the media and try to humanize Muslims and let them people know that just because somebody commits an act of terror, not all brown people are guilty.
Thank you so much. Arsalan Iftikhar, senior editor for the Islamic Monthly and founder of themuslimguy.com.
My pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, well, man, when I was a kid, if you even suggested that America would torture somebody, I mean, you were an outcast. I mean, watch a John Wayne movie from back then. Any war, whether it was World War II, Korea, or Vietnam, the scenario goes that, oh, the enemy is torturing one of our men, and we've got to find out where he is so we can rescue him. But we have one of their men. We're going to torture him and find out where. And then all of a sudden, John Wayne steps back. Oh, no, you don't. America doesn't do that. Those dirty commies do that. The enemy, whoever it is, they do that. We don't. Well, now we do. You know, thank you very much. I like living in a country that's now known to be the number one torture country in the world. We don't have the moral high ground at all. Now we just torture anybody that we want to. We don't even care if we get information because the information we're going to get isn't worth anything anyway. We just want to torture. It's just like the military-industrial complex. You know, why do we go to these wars? Well, the issue of the war has nothing to do with it. It's all these bombs that are sitting on the shelves unused. They're already sold. So the military-industrial complex won't make a dime on them until they sell you more. So we got to empty those shelves. Permanent war. That's what it's all about. Well, we're opening up the phone lines right now, first time in three shows now, I think. Anyway, 503-288-4448. and we're going to talk about this subject or whatever you think is more appropriate. In the meantime, Marcella's here, and she's going to bring us up to date on what Portland AE-911 Truth is up to.
Thank you, Bill. You've been watching Bill's show, 9/11 Was an Inside Job and Other State Crimes Against Humanity. And it's on the first and third Saturday of every month. So thanks for... and right now, we're going to be... Hopefully, we'll be getting up on the screen. I'm with the Portland Chapter of Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. And we have free library presentations of a particular DVD that's entitled 9/11 Explosive Evidence Experts Speak Out. And... it's a 90-minute documentary, and in it we present evidence that three skyscrapers went down on 9/11 in New York City. At the end of the presentation, we have a Q&A, and we hand out free DVDs of what you just saw. And we're just trying to educate. And so again, we're the Portland chapter. We're called the Portland chapter is called the Portland Action Group of Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. And we have in May we have Tuesday, March 14th, and Tuesday, March 21st. We have presentations on the 14th of May. We have at the Central Library, and on the 21st of May we have at Belmont Library, each from 6 to 8 p.m. And again, it's a presentation of the DVD 9/11 Explosive Evidence Experts Speak Out, and we do hand out free DVDs at the very end. The founder of Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth, his name is Richard Gage, and we had him here twice last year, and we'll be having him hopefully here in the month of June. And we will hopefully be having him, well, no, we won't hopefully, we will be having him here on Bill's show for an interview. So thank you very much for showing that.
And Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth is dedicated to the science of 9/11. They don't deal with conspiracy theories. We are the conspiracy analysts, not the theorists. We are analyzing the conspiracies that you see out there. But get your foothold with AE911Truth.org or Portland AE911Truth. And you find out scientifically it was a false flag operation. It was an inside job. Then from there you step back and take a look at the politics, the propaganda, the lies, the deceit, the cover-ups. Remember in the Nixon scandal, the crime was the cover-up. It wasn't really the break-in, it was the cover-up. Well, so we've got the live phone number up. Give us a call. In the meantime, I can play the another Amy Martin cut about the drone situation. You know, remote control killing.
Yeah,
all right. You know, we send out these drones to assassinate so-called high-value targets. And of course, takes out a wedding party of 200 innocent people, and we'll just ignore the fact that every one of those has a family that is now dedicated to hating America. And we caused it ourselves. They didn't start out that way. And it's absolutely amazing that the sheeple will listen over and over again to the Arabs did it, the Islamics did it, you know, and we sit there, man, I'm really afraid of Muslims now. Man, I'm not going to think about, wait a minute, how did the Muslims get past a multi-billion dollar defense system as if it wasn't even there? How did that happen? How could that happen? Well, they were Islamics. They can do it. We'll torture them and find out. I guess I'm being a little cynical, but jump in and make me sound more reasonable, will you?
Well, it's just really outrageous. Just the chronology of a lot of events that have happened, and the whole thing with what is it, Ryzen or Resin?
Oh yeah, Ryzen.
Yeah, that whole thing just is reminiscent to me of the anthrax.
Exactly.
After 9/11. And
well, how about
that?
That
was a false. I mean, that was really a false. People were set up.
Remember in 9/11 when they flew out Bin Laden's family? Everybody else was grounded, but they flew his whole family out. And it happened again. Another Saudi national gets busted, and it was announced that he was the, you know, we've caught the suspect and everything. And then it turned out, well, wait a minute, Michelle Obama just met with the guy at the White House. How, what? And then he's being flown out, deported. And they make some sort of behind the doors deal with the Saudis so that, you know, we won't talk about your involvement with 9/11. We won't talk about your involvement in the bombings or whatever it is now. We'll just put it, you know, the similarities are so amazing. Apparently, too many people are enjoying the good weather, not calling in. So I'm going to go ahead and play this one by Abby Martin, talking about the drones. So enjoy.
George W. Bush was joined by the four other living presidents to commemorate his newly opened presidential library. The dedication of this building was truly an emotional experience for all.
Mr. President, let me say that I'm filled with admiration for you and deep gratitude for you about the great contributions you've made to the most needy people on earth. I was impressed that President Bush invites us to make different decisions if we choose on the decisions he was facing. It's one of the most interesting things about this library.
So we know President Bush the man, and what President Clinton said is absolutely true. To know the man is to like the man.
It's the honor of a lifetime to lead a country as brave and as noble as the United States. Whatever challenges come before us, I will always believe our nation's best days lie ahead. God bless.
Oh, Bush. Well, of course America's best days are ahead. After all, how could we possibly topple the wrongs committed during your presidency? The illegal wars of aggression, the blatant use of torture against alleged enemies, the war on privacy, and that's just scratching the surface. Of course, while the media was tuned into Bush's tears, nobody mentioned his true Medal of Honor, that of a war criminal. And nobody pointed out how this library is blatantly whitewashing his legacy. And interestingly, one of the same day the government's lionizing Bush, Iraq, is falling into a bloody civil war, experiencing another series of bombings just today that left 35 dead. At the same time as this underreported tragedy is making headlines, the media is also ramping up the rhetoric of Syria's chemical weapons as a precursor to invade. Sound familiar? The irony of all this just made my head explode. So grab some pain pills and stick around to break the set. For weeks now, I've been reporting on this show and working off air to raise awareness about the dangers of the cyber bill CISPA. It's a bill that would allow private corporations to share private user information with the federal government under the auspices of protecting us from the looming cyber Pearl Harbor. Well, today, the bill essentially died in the Senate. But that's only sort of the good news. What if I told you that all the provisions inside this bill that are such a threat to privacy have already been part of everyday practice by the federal government? Yep. As troublesome as this sounds, the Department of Defense has been implementing a secret cybersecurity program that monitors online activities in the same exact way that CISPA would have legalized. And we know this because of documents recently obtained by the Electronic Privacy Information Center, or EPIC, through a recent FOIA request. In a statement issued about their findings, EPIC stated, "These documents concern a collaboration between the Defense Department, the Department of Homeland Security, and private companies to allow government monitoring of private internet networks." Now, some of you might wonder how the government could be getting away with this. I mean, don't we have privacy laws that would prevent this sort of egregious violation of our rights online? Well, that's the million-dollar question, isn't it? According to CNET's Declan McCullough, who's been reporting on the document's findings, senior Obama administration officials have secretly authorized the interception of communications carried on portions of networks operated by AT&T and other internet service providers, a practice that might otherwise be illegal under federal wiretapping laws. Let me repeat that. Secret authorization of online spying against federal law. Guys, this is huge. The Justice Department is authorizing giant telecommunication corporations to break federal privacy laws and granting them immunity to do so. Oh, keep in mind, if it weren't for this FOIA request, we wouldn't even know about the extent that the Pentagon had already ramped up online surveillance, with none the wiser. What's perhaps most ironic in this recent revelation, though, is that we've been so vocal about the dangerous implication of SPA passing when the worst of the bill is already being practiced entirely in secret. But I guess that's the Obama administration's MO. Violate our rights first, codify those violations into law second. Amidst last week's barrage of violence and tragedy, all eyes were on the media for breaking news. One such story from the Associated Press's official Twitter account at 1:07 p.m. on April 23rd tweeted the following disturbing news. It said, breaking, two explosions in the White House and Barack Obama is injured. Well, thousands of retweets instantly followed, only to find out minutes later that the report was completely false when AP revealed that their account had been hacked, and then they quickly redacted the story. But not quickly enough for the economy to take a hit. Check this out. The Dow Jones, which was up, suddenly plummeted within just 2 minutes of the tweet, and then recovered just as quickly as the news was debunked. This reveals just how integrated social media has become with global economic trends. So joining me now to discuss this story and more financial news is Perry Ann Waring, the host of Prime Interest, a brand new finance show to be launched right here on RT very soon. Thank you so much, Perry Ann.
Thank you.
So what does it mean for the stocks to respond so quickly to news of a potential attack? What the heck does this plunge of the Dow Jones even mean?
Well, what we may not realize is that the majority of trades are done electronically. It's estimated maybe about 95% of all trades are done electronically through high-frequency trading. So we have specialized trading firms that have algorithms that use formulas to trade on. And what we saw on the Dow Jones is now that they're monitoring social media. About 3 weeks ago, the SEC ruled that public companies could put information about investments on social media. And this is the most recent development of that.
So break this down a little bit further, because I mean, for people who don't really understand what algorithms are, I mean, when something reacts so quickly and takes a plummet and then goes back up, I mean, we're talking about actually these things are being automated. I mean, things are literally being automated on the stock market.
So it's not humans. Computers have taken over, and that's why it happens so fast. And that's why during this market crash we saw this week, it happened within less than 10 minutes. The Dow Jones crashed and it came back up, and only something electronically could respond that fast.
Right. So what you're saying is robots are taking over the planet. I'm just kidding. No, it's scary because I can't help but think what's going to happen when something real does happen and the stock market does plummet. That is a really interesting question to ask. But while we're on the subject of finance and the internet, I want to ask you about the Marketplace Fairness Act. This is a new bill, a lot of proponents and opponents on both sides of the coin. What does this bill entail and how could it affect online commerce?
Right, this is the online sales tax. And what it does is it requires online companies that sell products online to collect, remit and calculate the sales tax to whoever's buying in whatever state they live in. So if you're Amazon and you sell across all 50 states, this is going to be a major regulatory burden on your business. So larger businesses like Amazon will probably be able to absorb those costs, but some of the smaller online retailers might not.
And so what are the proponents and opponents saying is to benefit and lose from this?
Well, people are calling it the Marketplace Fairness Act because brick and mortar stores are competing against internet stores, and internet stores are getting away with not collecting all the taxes at times. So people who are for it are brick and mortar stores. But there's also an $84 million lobbying force behind this from Verizon and Viacom. So there's a lot that's going into the works on who's pushing it and who's not.
Right, yeah. Sometimes it just takes a look at who's pushing the bill to really find out who stands to benefit the most. Some criticism that I've heard about the bill, though, is that it's kind of like a taxation without representation, because it's kind of this, you're pooling all your money if you shop a lot online and you don't really know where the taxes are going to. I mean, is that kind of an accurate assessment of a critique of the bill?
Well, one thing that members are saying who support the bill is that these are taxes that already exist. It's called the use tax on online goods. And apparently you're supposed to collect these taxes when you file at the end of the year and pay them to your states. So what this would do is enforce the use tax.
Personally, I think the fair tax is a really interesting concept, something that I think we should talk about on a later show. But speaking of buying stuff online, Bitcoin seems to be the new popular trend, this decentralized online currency. Talk about what it is and why it's gaining popularity.
So Bitcoins are a crypto digital currency. They have a set amount. I think it's 21 million or something close to that. There's about 19 million already mined. It's technically still a fiat currency, but the reason why I like it is because it's a free market invention. It's not something that's centralized through our governments, through central bankers. This was designed by a smaller company. And we're starting to see a lot of people flock to alternative means of money. So we have Bitcoins, more people are starting to barter with all the recent developments of currency devaluation across the globe. But there are issues with Bitcoins. It may not be the fix-all problem to our monetary systems, but it is it's interesting to start to see these types of currencies and technologies evolve, and I think this is just the beginning of digital currencies, and we're going to see more and more pop up.
Right, this is just the beginning of kind of that line of thinking to really create something outside of this top-down banking model that's kind of controlling the world right now. Let's talk about your new show, Prime Interest, Farianne, launching very soon on RT. What can we expect from it?
So Prime Interest is going to be an economic finance show. We're not going to be following the market. I'm not going to tell you the statistics on a day-to-day basis. We're going to get into those details that the mainstream media is not picking up on. We're going to get into the fine print of what's in your prime interest. And I have great producers. We have Bob English and Justine Underhill, who we're all working very hard to bring a great package. It's going to release very soon on RT on the 4:30 time slot, right before your show, very soon.
Cool. Awesome. Thank you so much, Perry and Boyne. Prime Interest coming up soon.
Thank you.
And if you're wondering what I'm doing when I'm not on air, check me out on...
Okay, well, we didn't exactly play the clip on drones. That's coming up now, but we only have like 2 minutes before we go off the air. And, I could do a two-hour show or even...
We're considering it.
Expand it to once a week.
Yeah, and even try it out for a quarter. Maybe like around September.
Yeah, we might do that.
Yeah.
Well, what do you think? Let us know. You can contact us on our email at 251omega@comcast.net. We'll be back in 2 weeks. That would make it, the 18th, right?
Yeah. Yes.
I can add 14 to 4. Okay. Well, it's just amazing what's going on. Think about what we're going through. Watch what happens in the next 2 weeks. And
especially what happens with that rise in...
Oh, the rise in...
I wish I knew if I was saying that right.
Yeah, rise in.
Yeah, just to see... Yeah, because so far both people have... that's been interesting.
Oh, and here's another thing. Remember just before the election, there were Democrats saying, if Romney wins, I'm going to assassinate him. If Romney wins, we ought to shoot him. And those guys didn't ever get prosecuted. But just recently, a 16-year-old high school student, used the F-bomb in a Facebook. He said, Omega. Is that a Freudian slip?
F-Obama.
And so on. And the U.S. government like that. And they're prosecuting him. They want to put him away for 20 years.
Oh, my gosh.
And, our country is horrible.
Well, to see any of Bill's past shows, please go to 251 Omega on YouTube.
It's our government that's horrible. I love
Omega.
My country, but I'm ashamed of my government. There you go.
Ooh, that's a good one, yeah. And please go to portland8911truth.org for any upcoming presentations for our group. And, yeah, and we'll be here in 2 weeks.
Thanks for watching. Oh, that's kind of...
We'll be back in 2 weeks.
But anyway, see you then.
Yes.